Was trying to say thank you very much first to the organizer for this opportunity to present on some of the work that we are currently doing at Janssen in the search for treatments for Alzheimer's disease. And secondly, and most importantly, I hope that all the people online as well as your families are safe in under the current tremendous circumstances that we are currently dealing with. Okay, yeah. So I don't think I need to convince anyone about the relevance of Alzheimer's disease to our society. But some of the figures related to the illness are so hard to believe that I feel I have to share some at least. So in terms of economic cost, the associated cost with Alzheimer's disease in the US is estimated to be around $300 billion per year. Just in the US, and this is expected to triple to more than $1 trillion by 2015. Most importantly, in terms of social and even personal cost, although in terms of death rates or the death rate for other highly prevalent diseases such as heart rate have decreased in the recent years to around 10%, deaths associated with Alzheimer's disease have increased by 145%. And currently, Alzheimer's disease kills more than breast cancer. Combined. OGA stands for ogluconase, and this is a cytosolic glycosidase that has to be differentiated from other ER and Golgi located glycosidases that are important for trafficking and secretion of proteins. In this case, glucuronacylation is a post-translational modification of many different proteins that involves the introduction of a single sugar residue, N-acetylglucosamine, into serine and threonines of these proteins. And this post-translational modification is implicated in many very relevant cellular processes. In contrast to other post-translational modifications, such as phosphorylation, in which there are hundreds of kinases and phosphatases involved in the process, there are only two proteins, a transferase, OGA, that either install the sugar residue, and a hydrolase, OGA, that removes the sugar residue from these target proteins. Alzheimer's disease is characterized by the formation of abnormal protein aggregates in the brain, senile plaques made of amyloid peptide, and neurofibrillary tangles made of hyperphosphorylated type protein. And it is currently, there is currently a great consensus with regard to, in this case, the disease trajectory correlates very well with tauopathy or tau pathology, spreading and severity. And in fact, this spreading has some peculiar features. It always starts in the same area in the brain, and it spreads according to a very specific pattern, always through areas that are connected physically. In our case, we want to interfere with this intracellular tau aggregation in order to slow down this templating or spreading feature of tau that in the end contributes to disease progression. And we want to do so by increasing tau, which is one of OGA client proteins, glucuronacylation to prevent this cascade of processes. What is the connection between tau glucuronacylation and Alzheimer's disease? In this case, postmortem studies have shown how tau glucuronacylation is reduced in AD brains compared to healthy controls. And as well as in vitro, it has been shown that tau glucuronacylation lowers the speed and yield of tau aggregation. Furthermore, and since glucuronacylation and phosphorylation are taking place onto the same residues on proteins, glucuronacylation may compete as well with tau phosphorylation in this case, yielding to eventually, or blocking this process could eventually yield to a partial rescue function of tau. And finally, and most importantly, subchronic treatment with different OGA inhibitors has been shown to decrease tauopathy in different transgenic mice models. The most widely used tool compound is a sugar-based derivative, thiamethG, that in fact is a mimic of the transition state of the catalytic process. For this compound, efficacy in a couple of different transgenic mice models has been reported at relatively high doses, 500 milligrams per kilogram per day. And this is likely reflecting the poor brain properties of a highly polar molecule. To the best of our knowledge, there are currently three OGA clinical assets. Very recently, Merck and Alectos have reported the structure of the first one, the one shown here, which is a close analog of thiamethG. And in this case, phase one data release have shown that the compound is very well tolerated, as well as have confirmed brain target engagement, in this case through PET scans. Aseneuron has also reported phase one data for their asset. In this case, their structure is unknown, and showing as well a very good tolerability profile in phase one studies. And in this case, this compound is currently planned to enter into phase two for PSP, another tauopathy. And finally, Eli Lilly is currently running phase one studies with a compound, again, of an unknown structure. But in this case, they are also developing a potential PET tracer, the piperidine derivative shown on the slide, also to be used in humans. So I don't think I will surprise anyone with our target product profile, but basically we are looking for a potent OGA inhibitor, both in our biochemical as well as in our cell-based assay, highly selective, preclinical profile acceptable for subchronic treatment, of course, brain permeable. And we also want to prove in vivo OGA inhibition at doses significantly lower to the reference molecule, thiamethG. And we also want to see how this in vivo OGA inhibition translates into a reduction of tau pathology in relevant transgenic mice models. In this case, and since we are probably talking about a potential chronic treatment in senior people, likely polymedicated, we want a extremely benign safety profile. This means very little or no potential for drug-drug interaction, no alerts in terms of toxicity, as well as high as possible safety margins. As a hit finding strategy, we perform an in silico screen of our compound collection using to build our models the very few non-sugar based OGA inhibitors that were reported at that time. This exercise resulted in identification of compound number one that showed a very potent OGA inhibition in our biochemical assay, 200 nanomolar, but almost negligible activity in our cell-based assay. We attributed this poor cellular efficacy to the presence of a highly polar sulfon moiety. And in fact, in this case, replacement of the sulfon moiety by a CH2 worked very nicely, resulting in compound two, which is already a 2-digit nanomolar inhibitor in both assays. Unfortunately, we have to put this series on hold because in this case, this acyanidol containing molecules suffer from very poor brain exposure and we couldn't improve this property. In this case, we perform a further exploration of what we call the northern part of the molecule, and this resulted in the identification of our lead molecule, OGA or OGA1, which is a single-digit nanomolar inhibitor in both our biochemical as well as our cell-based assay. In terms of our medicinal chemistry strategy or exploration strategy around this molecule, we confirmed pretty soon in the program that we needed a basic center, and in this case, basicity modulation had a strong impact on potency. We also explore alternate cyclic amine-based central cores, and this also had some impact on potency and metabolic stability. The compound contains a distal aryl group, and in this case, this group is able to modulate ADME properties, mainly with little influence on potency of the molecule, And we also explore different linkers between our central core and our Dealstar Aryl. And in this case, this exploration resulted or confirmed impact of this modification, both in potency as well as in metabolic stability. And finally, we also tried to either replace or modify our acetamidotiazole motif, but we found that this was nearly impossible. In this case, very close modifications, such as just moving the position of the nitrogen of the core, replacing by a pyridine, which is a well-known bioisostere, methylation of the NH, methylation of the carbonyl, or swifting or swapping the position between the nitrogen and the sulfur, resulted in almost completely abolishment of activity. We wanted to understand what was the peculiarity for this acetamidotiazole motif. And in this case, we took advantage that the OGA is crystallography enabled. In this case, we use a bacterial ortholog, the so-called CP-OGA, and we managed to crystallize our OGA molecule into this bacterial OGA. The analysis of the X-ray derived structure confirmed that in this case, the basic center is forming a very strong charge interaction with an aspartate residue, and this is helping to hold in place the acetamidotiazole motif that in this case is the one that goes deeply into the real catalytic pocket of the enzyme. And in this case, this is held in place by a very strong network of different H-bond interactions. In terms of the profile of our molecule, as I mentioned before, the compound is a very potent single-digit nanomolar in both our biochemical and cell-based assay, and it doesn't show speciation in this case versus a mouse cell line. It's highly selective versus other succinylases and against the SERP panel of more than 80 receptor and enzymes. It sits in a very nice physicochemical property space for a CNS molecule, so moderate lipophilicity, moderate polar surface area, and moderate basicity, resulting in high ligand efficiency, as well as very high CNS MPO score. In this case, the maximum for this score for a CNS molecule is 6. The compound is highly permeable in our MDCK cell line, but in contrast, it shows some potential PGP-mediated efflux potential. It's a highly soluble and easy to formulate into a standard vehicle's molecule. And in terms of metabolic stability, it shows high clearance in mouse microsomes, reducing in human liver microsomes, and shows very high free fraction, not only in plasma, but also with regard to brain tissue. Shows very modest inhibition of 3A4 and very or much less for the other isoforms, and little potential for induction of PHR or AHR. It doesn't show any in vitro alert with regard to potential toxicity profile, and it doesn't bind to any of the cardiac ion channels, as well as it shows very little proarrhythmic potential in our pluripotential cardiomyocyte-derived cell line. In terms of mouse PK, the compound shows lower than anticipated by the in vitro data clearance. It shows also high degree of distribution into the tissues and very good half-life for a rodent species. In terms of the PO profile, the compound shows a very high oral bioavailability, around 75%. The compound gets into the brain, and in this case, the brain-to-plasma ratio is greater than 1. In terms of in vivo target engagement, OGA1 is able to block OGA in mouse brain, as confirmed by the fact that the compound is able to increase, this is the green line, the total the glucuronylation of the total protein content in mouse brain, with a maximal effect similar but lower to the reference molecule Thiamet G. And in our case, in the case of our molecule, The compound, as well as TIMG, shows the delayed efficacy. In this case, the peak effect is obtained after 8 hours. We think that basically this just reflects the mechanism of action, because in this case, once we block OGA, which is the hydrolase that removes the sugar residue from proteins, it takes some time to the transferase to install the motif. And in this case, and compared to TIMG, the effects of OGA1 were found to be transient. And we think that this was basically due to the PK profile of the molecule. We decided to explore alternative dosing regime in order to run our chronic and subchronic experiments. And in this case, we administered the compound to mice 14 days in drinking water. And in this case, as it can be seen on the left graph, the compound is able, the blue curve, to sustain increase in protein glucuronacylation in mice brain over 24 hours, again with similar but lower efficacy compared to TIMG. On the right, you can see the quantification of the area under the curve for the previous graph, and this graph confirms that our molecule at around 100 milligrams per kilogram, it's able to increase threefold the content of glucuronacylated proteins in mice brain. Finally, we explore the pharmacology of our molecule in the P301S mice. This is a mutant progranulative tau mice model, and we use similar doses to the one shown on the previous slide. So in this case, the compound was administered in drinking water, targeting 100 MPK dose for OGA1 and around 500 MPK for TIMG. Both compounds were able to block the target in vivo, as shown on the previous slide, again with similar efficacies. And in this case, both molecules were able to reduce the amount of aggregated tau in this mice model. For the detection of, in this case, we use sandwich ELISA using the PT51 antibody as a capture antibody as well as detection antibody. And this allows us to capture, let's say, aggregated tau from dimers, in this case, regardless of phosphorylation potential. We use other antibodies as well to detect different tau species, and in all the cases, we did see basically the same results as shown here. And also, it's important to note that in this case, this reduction of aggregated tau doesn't come from a reduction of total tau levels that basically are maintained, in this case, both compared to vehicle to the same level. So as a kind of summary, we have identified a compound that is a highly potent OGA inhibitor in vitro, selective versus related targets as well as other targets, that has allowed to test our hypothesis in subchronic experiments in mice, leading to an in vivo OGA inhibition with doses around 100 MPK, which is significantly lower compared to the TIMG doses normally used, which are around 500 MPK. We have confirmed also reduction of tau pathology in transgenic mice models. And in this case, at least the preliminary data we have with regard to toxicology also confirm a relatively benign profile for this molecule. And that was it. Thank you very much. And if you have any question, I would be more than happy trying to answer those.
Can I say something?
Yeah, sure.
I think that it is the problem with the model, as I say in my talk, that you have a very good, nice result in your model, but try to make a model, the primary cell culture, or that will be translated to the people after, because it will not working in the people. This is the major problem of all research. Thank you.
Thank you for your comment.
Thank you very much.